Hi, I'm Stephanie Underwood, Creative Lead at Precis Digital.
Hi, I'm Sara Mattsson, Creative Lead at Google in Sweden.
This is Precis Talks, and today we're going to talk about data-driven creativity. It's oftentimes the perception that when data influences too many parts of the creative process, that these connections with consumers and especially this brand connection is oftentimes lost. What do you say about that?
I think that machine learning and data, it's not here to replace the job of creativity. We need both. They need to work together. And so absolutely, they can definitely work together. It's a lot in this data-driven process, and it can look very different from different brands. So I think it can definitely work together, and I think that every brand needs to think about how they can continuously test, learn, experiment all the time, and I think that's where really the data comes in. One different part here is that you mentioned this in the beginning, is to of course align all stakeholders from the brief, the creative agency, everyone at the brand, of course, and the media agency, maybe the production company as well. Everyone needs to be aligned on what they're creating for in the beginning to really adopt a process where you can use data continuously. And then about the creative freedom, because this is also something that maybe some creators think that they can't use too much data, it kind of destroys the creativity. But I always think that there's always been creative limitations. For example, if you're creating for a TV ad, you're limited by time. You're limited by 30 seconds or 60 seconds. While with digital, you have so many other creative freedoms. Yeah. For example, with YouTube, I think it's an amazing platform, of course, yeah. And it gives a lot of freedom. You're not limited by time. You can tell a story. You can really take the time to tell a story, because you, with data, we can know who's watching the ad, and you can say, you can build a sequence of ads, video ad sequencing. You can say that if person A sees the first one, we want the person A to see the second ad and the third ad. So you can have someone see a sequence of ads. And that allows a lot of creative freedom. Mm-hmm. You can really tell a story over time. So I think that data is a tool that really helps us make better ads and better creatives.
Yeah, absolutely. I think you said a lot of really important things in there. I think to start off with, instead of like seeing data and creative or creativity on opposite ends of the spectrum, perhaps it should be seen as something that's on different sides of the same coin, so to say, that they really influence and impact each other. And data really holds the power to inform, and creativity really holds the power to inspire. So when you have kind of an equal mix of the two, it's really, really, really important. And I know that one thing that you touched on a little bit was kind of work process and workflow when it comes to data and the importance of testing. And I know that that's something here at Precis that's extremely important, especially like the testing process and making sure that you have a good testing framework, making sure that you can validate hypotheses and that you can actually have kind of a log to go back to and see all of the different ways that you think that you can influence creative and influence performance, so that you can share like those insights with different stakeholders and things like that. And generally a way that we've seen that works well in the past is doing kind of a monthly iterative process and looking at your hypotheses and seeing the growth of the creative over time and how much it's changed and whatnot. So I think that's...
I agree. We work the same way at Google when we work with experiments, really like try to come up with an hypothesis and then test it, and not always just A-B testing, maybe set up 3-4 different creatives so it's just not two, you're testing with it towards each other. So I think we have some clients that globally that continuously testing, and they have a bunch of hypotheses they want to test, and they, I mean, brands run campaigns all the time, so they have a lot of time to test different things, and then they come back maybe to the first one that didn't work out the way it intended from the beginning. So it's very inspiring to see.
Yeah, absolutely.
I wish more brands did more testing.
Yeah, me too, actually. I think we're definitely trying to push that forward a little bit with our clients, at least, because I think it's really interesting to be able to not just see if a creative performed, but actually how a creative performed and which elements within that creative actually drive that performance overall, so that ultimately you can just continue to improve over time.
But also in this process, and we talked about this before as well, it's so important to really feed back the results to the creative agency and to all stakeholders, so they know what to start from next time, so they don't start from the beginning.
Yeah.
So they really like can work off like the data, and I think maybe the creativity is just to make this work.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I think that, like, to touch back on what you said, like really getting all of the relevant stakeholders in a room, and instead of it being creative over here and data over here, like really coming together and see how the sides influence each other. It saves time and money, and allows people to take risks, and kind of alleviates a lot of the consequences that can come if you don't put all the people in the same room in the beginning. So, given this data-driven workflow and having incorporating data into the process, how do you think this resonates or works when it comes to scalability?
That's interesting, and it's often, I'm sure you hear it too, a common objection that we can't scale this, it's too expensive, it's too complicated, it doesn't have to be. It doesn't have to be expensive, it doesn't have to be too complicated. It's we all seen and heard those cases where there are maybe hundreds and thousands of different ads. You don't need to start there as a brand. You can start identifying maybe 10 or 20 audiences that you want to work with, and then from there try out different creatives. And something that we done experiments with, and I think you have too here at Precis, done a lot of experimentation around copy only. Mm-hmm. So you can have the same creative asset, same video asset as a base, and then you're changing the copy to the different audiences you identified. So that's the only thing that changes in the video. But then of course, back to what we talked about before, if everyone's aligned on what you're creating for and what this specific ad is supposed to do, then it's pretty easy to have it from the beginning. But it's nothing, you don't work with scalability at the end.
No.
You have that in the brief from the beginning, so the creators and the creative directors can work with that in mind from the beginning. And going back to the copy example, so where we've seen this works extra well is for shorter bumper ads specifically. So the shorter the ad is, the more work you can do with only changing the copy, and it has better effect on results. If you work with longer trivias, you need to make more customization to with images to make it more relevant. And all this customization I'm talking about, it's of course because we as consumers, I mean, it's pretty easy to reach a consumer today frequently. You can reach anyone with remarketing. And but we as consumers, we are so used to getting what we want when we want it. And we want it to be relevant. So with just small changes like the copy, you can be more relevant to some audiences.
Yeah, absolutely. I completely agree. And I think what you said in the beginning there about there's this perception that everything needs to be big budget and highly produced and whatnot. But I mean, you can make a lot of really small changes and really maximize your creative and the investment that you make a lot more than most people actually realize. I mean, cutting the content and doing different lengths and changing out the copy and call to action and things like that, it really can make a huge impact and a big difference. And I think that it's sometimes overlooked. A lot of money can be spent on a big production, and then it's not ever used again. The actual base content isn't. So there's really a lot that you can kind of repurpose and reuse, and especially to verify different hypotheses. And if you use content like that to verify hypotheses, then you can actually put those learnings and insights into a bigger production, and actually saves time and money in the end.
Yeah,
overall.
Exactly. You can start with maybe identifying 5 different audiences, and then you scale up to 100.
Kind of the last thing that we want to discuss is, now that we've kind of discussed the workflow and different elements of data-driven creativity and the importance of it, I think one really important topic is evaluation and how can it be evaluated. Do you have any insight on that?
I think we should start in the end. Like, not one creative can do everything, which it's pretty common to get. It's pretty common that I see a brief with the one video creative, and it's supposed to drive sales and awareness and consideration and, well, everything else as well. And I think it's really important to start from the beginning, to know what creative is doing what, and maybe also think about how you write a brief for digital to make it to different platforms. Not all digital platforms are the same. Yeah. Sometimes I see YouTube and Facebook at the same line in the media plan. They're not the same either. Yeah. So before you start evaluating something, know what you're creating for. Know what KPI this specific creative is supposed to drive and what you want to do with it. And then brief everyone at the same time, and then, like we talked about in the beginning, make sure you have that feedback loop on the what happened last campaign, what can we bring in, what were the learnings that we can bring into this one.
I think one really important thing that you said was in the very beginning, when you discussed that one creative can't take care of all solutions. And I think that that's really, really, really important, because when you don't have people in the same room, oftentimes there's not alignment on what the objective of the campaign and the creative actually is. So you might have the creators that are actually building from a brand perspective, but the purpose of the campaign is actually to drive sales. And by the time that actually gets to the media buyers or digital specialists here at Precis, we can't actually use it, or it doesn't actually maximize the performance to the best of the ability, because it actually wasn't created to drive sales. So
and then everyone's going to be unhappy.
And then everybody's going to be unhappy, exactly. So I mean, one way to fix that, as you said, is, like, get everybody in the same room. That's the first thing. Then align on the objective of the campaign. What are you actually creating for? Then it is to align on KPIs. And perhaps it's also good to build a KPI framework that really allows you to kind of evaluate, if it's a brand campaign, how will we evaluate it? If it's supposed to drive sales, how will we evaluate it? What are the KPIs we're going to use to do this? And as you said, really test and learn and iterate, like, which types of messages and which type of creative work for these different objectives, because they won't be the same.
Yeah, and also, like, with the testing and experiments, really think about when you get the results from an experiment, think about, was it enough customization between the different creatives that we could actually, like, evaluate the correct thing?
Exactly.
And really, like, question what you did in the setup, and then look at results again, and maybe do it again if you're a little bit unsure, because it's not easy, but it's not even, like, it's not too complicated either. But I think all the companies that are using data, insights, experimentation, they have a competitive advantage.
Absolutely. I think that to be honest, kind of not putting those two parties in the same room and not looking at that as we said before, kind of different sides of the same coin, that you're actually at a disadvantage and you risk the chance of not moving forward.
Yeah, definitely. So data can definitely make the creative better, but it can also make creativity better.
Yeah.